Executive Director and Chief Operations Officer for CASBO. Thank you for joining us in this conversation around the human resources considerations as we look to reopen schools. I'm joined today by Sarah Baches. Sarah is our Chief Governmental Relations Officer here at CASBO. And we have a very distinguished guest joining us today, Nina Boyd. Nina is CASBO's past president, and she's the Associate Superintendent of Governance, Leadership, and Community Partnerships for Orange County Department of Education. Nina, thank you for joining us today as we explore this conversation and hear from our members of questions and concerns that they have. Your expertise is going to be really valuable in this listening session. So thank you for taking the time to join us. Let me just kind of set the framework for the conversations that we're about to have. I'm going to first start by saying that this is a listening session. We in no way have the answers to all of the questions that are circulating, and certainly more have added to that pile since last evening, this morning's announcement on the budget. So this is really a listening session, and you're going to hear me say that a couple times. But let me share with you a little bit of backdrop for how we're here and why we're here. The tireless work of our Legislative Advocacy Committee at CASBO and the quality of work that they've done, along with our government relations team and our leader members, has allowed us to be invited to the table for some very important conversations around education. I want to share those. One is with the management organizations, CSBA, CSESA, the Small School Districts Association, and ACSA have united to say we are a coalition with one aim, and that is to inform the policymakers right now so we don't end up in a situation of the tail wagging the dog of what this is really going to take to reopen schools in a very practical matter. And I know today's news, it's easy to get overwhelmed, to say the least, but one of the nuances that have come out of the last 24 hours is the understanding that this state needs us. The state needs the schools to open in order to restart the economy. And I think that gives us a little bit more boldness, if you will, in our communications at the state level. So I've talked about that management group. We're also, we were in nightly conversations with the governor's office to help try to reshape some of those executive orders that were coming out, to try to certainly respond very quickly to things like, oh, schools are going to open in July. That was very alarming. And so we kind of came back again with thoughtful insight as to the complexities, the budget that would be needed, the interdependencies of all of these disciplines to reopen. But that's another call that we're actively involved in. And then finally, Tony Thurman's group, the Superintendent of Public Education, has pulled together a task force. I think we have 30 entities involved in that, including the folks in labor. And Sarah has been appointed the lead on the budget conversations on that task force. So again, because of the work of our Legislative Advocacy Committee and our tireless efforts from our members, we're at the table, and there's not one conversation that's taken place. You know, we certainly talk about the student safety. We talk about, you know, their ability to learn, and then it starts to immediately resolve to what does maintenance and operations look like? What is child nutrition, transportation, and all of these topics that we have spent the last week now talking to about 700, maybe 650 to 700 folks, hearing from you the questions that you have around all of these as we explore them. So again, being at the table, we just felt it was very important for us to reach out to those that are doing the job and explore with you some of the models that you might be looking at. We're hearing, you know, half day for one group, flipping the classroom, half day for another, brings up all kinds of issues around, you know, maintenance and operations, and certainly transportation. People are like, we can't double our buses, we can't double our staff. That's one model. Certainly there's like this Monday, Wednesday, Friday and flipping. And then we even see in other countries, some schools are opening their K through sixth first so that those parents can get back to work and maybe the older children, you know, kind of in a staged path there. So You know, as we explore these, we want to understand maybe some of the models that you're considering, again, not with the answers, but with more questions that we intend to work to get those questions answered, to use those questions to inform the policymakers, and then to turn this information back to you in terms of content, best practices, and tools that you might use as we begin the work ahead, again, you know, to reopen schools. One of the things that we're very clear about is that, you know, while the light switch sort of went off in terms of schools closing, it is going to be a local decision. So we know that there is not one size that fits all. We know that there will be many variations that will require tremendous relationships with your county offices and the public health officials. But again, our intent is to try to analyze the questions that we have and these impacts, you know, in varying size and rurals and such. And Sarah will talk more about that in a moment. Once we get these questions culminated, we're breaking them into these buckets around policy and funding that you see on the slides here, continuity of learning, and that's how these resources are going to be coming back out to you as some of this information takes shape. And then finally, you know, again from today, is to use the information to advocate for funding. Again, you know, with the news this morning, we understand that we are being asked to do more now than ever. And so we'll see how that takes shape, but also to, you know, what legislative and regulatory areas are we asking for relief? And Sarah will send, excuse me, we'll share some of that. Before I forget, when we're talking about the budget, Mike Fine last night agreed to have a webinar for us on Wednesday at 9 a.m. You'll see an announcement go out on that really quickly to help us try to digest some different options available around the new budget discussion. So just look for that. That'll be a very well attended conversation ahead of the state budget announcement on May 14th. So with that as the introduction, again, our listening session, we wanted to start that off with just an amazing lady, Nina Boyd. And Nina, thank you for joining us and sharing your perspective on the human resources considerations as we move forward.
Thank you, Tasha. And hello to everyone out there. Our new norm of WebEx meetings and Zoom meetings continues. I know that it's been challenging for some, and others have adapted to it much easier, but just know that all of us are facing many of the same challenges. And so as we try to get used to a new norm and create a new norm, I think it's really important that we're also stepping back to strategically talk and think about some of the impacts as we move forward. So I appreciate the opportunity that CASPO has presented in having this dialogue, because I think it's much needed. And it's really another opportunity for us to share. And hopefully, as Tasha said, we don't have the answers. And hopefully that you came on this call to help identify areas that we need to look at and to be cognizant of. And at the same time, maybe you'll hear something that will spark a different conversation in your own entity to further the interest in terms of the return to work that needs to take place. So all of us know how we got here, but one of the challenges, I think that some districts, us included, we have been so focused on our distance learning plan for students and what we're providing for students that we haven't spent as much time dialoguing about when we actually bring our employees back to the workplace. And when we do that, what it looks like, what are our expectations, as well as what are our employees' expectations. And so I think it's really key to have conversations with leadership with regards to what are the expectations of employees when they come back, because some of the challenges that we know that we're going to face and need to figure out are around protecting our higher risk employees due to age or underlying conditions or care of elder parents and or folks who are sick or have illnesses that are in the high risk group living in their homes. And so as we identify a plan, then we also need to make sure that we are taking into consideration that not all of our employees are going to be able to return to work in the timeframe that we identify. Another key issue is whether or not we bring all of our employees back at one time or whether we look to some type of phase-in. Some of our work areas are already inclusive of social distancing, and so that won't be as difficult for us in bringing individuals back into the workplace. But in some situations, that's not the case. And I would say, look at all of the workspaces across your district and or county office, because our central administrative offices and the employees working in those areas, it's very different than our site-based. And so in terms of our school sites, many of our office staff are in very small, tight capacities in terms of work areas, just by the very nature of how the school is designed. And so you want to make sure that there are considerations with regards to when you're sending out communications to staff, that the targeted groups are not feeling alienated by virtue of where they work, that it's specific to addressing their environment and their workspace, along with whatever else considerations that you might need to do there. The other issue and challenge that we all know is just walkthroughs in our offices, in our schools, that there are spaces that although our employees may physically have social distancing in terms of their work areas, but there are common areas that people have to either go to a common copier or they're going to the break room. And how are we going to address the needs of our employees throughout the workday in terms of mandatory breaks and lunch and, you know, some of those types of just normal things that we wouldn't think about in terms of our workspace. Additionally, we're challenged with the additional cleaning that needs to take place and how we're going to address what needs to be done in terms of as different employees use equipment. Are we going to state that everyone needs to wear gloves? Some people have had that conversation. Others are saying, well, we're sterilizing every night. And then throughout the day, we have people coming through. But if you have walk-up copier machines or printers where people are, multiple people are using that, if you have common space for in terms of refrigerators where people put their lunches and store food items, just where you go to get coffee, all of those things are things that would not be on the norm for us to just think about, because we're thinking about bringing people back to work to get the work that needs to be done taken care of. But I would caution that we need to make sure that the care of our employees is also essential in our planning, because how we treat them is going to be what they remember, along with what we are asking them to do. Another area is many of us have employees that visit offsite workspaces. They're either other companies, or it might be that we're requiring employees to go to different spaces for trainings or to pick up materials or equipment. And so are those going to be things that you continue to allow individuals to do, or are those things that are not part of your, let's just say, phase one, phase two, or even phase three in terms of when you bring employees back? And I'm talking about thinking about electricians, maintenance workers, people that even our food service workers, they typically are allowed via open purchase orders and requisitions to go out into the field and pick up things. And so are those things that we will continue to allow them to do, or do we create some new norms around that as a result of what we're currently doing in response to COVID-19? One of the other major areas that I think is concerning all of us is the CARES Act, and the fact that when we do send notice for our employees to return to work, that if they have children or students under the age of 18 that require childcare, that and they don't have childcare, they may tell us that they can't return to work. And so they may fall under that 10-week leave that has been granted. And so there are some things that we need to ensure that we are surveying, you know, where our employees are in terms of some of the things that are being offered by both the state and the federal government. I saw also a red alert that came out to HR and risk managers that was issued on May 6th, another executive order from the governor related to workers' compensation. And if individuals are diagnosed with COVID-19, there are some presumptions around workers' comp claims that could now be coming to us. And that time period has been identified from March 19th through July 5th, 2020. So if we're reopening sometime between now and July 5th, and we have employees that now come down with COVID-19 or diagnosed with it, then are we potentially creating some additional liabilities around workers' comp claims? So we want to make sure that we are aware of that executive order, that we're dialoguing with our risk management group and our attorneys with regards to the types of requirements that we are envisioning, because we don't want to set up things where we think we're protecting ourselves and our employees, and in fact, we're creating an opening for additional liabilities to the organization. So I think we also need to take some care and be very careful there. One of the other things that people are asking about is flexibility with the calendar. And those are conversations that naturally districts will need to have with their management group, with their certificated, with their classified and all bargaining groups. I would caution that you don't want to rush into MOUs and agreements with bargaining group members at this time. There are a lot of code sections that allow flexibility for management. And we are going to be pushed to try to agree to set up some things, because our employees will have some expectations around additional pay, or let's say hazardous pay. We have some for if they're now required to do distance learning versus in classroom learning. Some individuals will make an argument that because of the use of technology and creating lesson plans and so forth, that there are some hardships or some things that require some additional pay around that. If we're looking at flex schedules in terms of having students come in on different days or at different hours, so that as we're bringing and returning students back into the school setting, what are we doing in terms of ensuring that we have the teaching staff and the paraprofessionals that will be able to work with them. So I know I've opened the door around a lot of different issues that we need to be thinking about, but I'm hoping that I've sparked some questions that we can direct to Sarah and Tasha to further their conversation as they have a seat at the table with the governor's task force and committee. And the last thing that I'll leave you with before I, you know, go silent and listen is think also about what regulations and code sections that we might want to also request relief and or some waivers. We've been working on that. Sarah has reached out in the past and asked those questions. But I think as we're looking at returning employees to work, and looking at startup of a new school year and our students, whether it be distance learning or back in person, that there may be additional code sections and or regulations that are hindering some of our abilities to move some things forward. And so this is a perfect opportunity, since these ladies have a seat at the table, for them to have a dialogue about what those might be. So with that, I'll hand off so that we can start the additional dialogue that we're going to have with Sarah and Tasha.
Thank you so much, Nina. We always appreciate your perspective. This conversation really came about after the shock that we felt last Tuesday when Governor Newsom announced in a 4-point resiliency roadmap that schools can open beginning in July. One of the factors that was not included in that conversation is the key criteria as needed by the state in order to ensure that schools can safely reopen, and that there are many components the state must first address, such as stabilization in hospitalization numbers, making sure that there's sufficient equipment, personal protective equipment and supplies to meet the demand, that there's sufficient testing capacity, and contact tracing statewide. And so once we began this process of really ensuring that we had a voice at the table and that any of those discussions included each and every perspective of our CASBO members, we realized it was important to open up these venues. Our hope for today's conversation is to ensure that CASBO can work in developing a coordinated effort at the federal, state, and local levels to ensure that guidance is coordinated, that we have strong partnership, that we mitigate any potential ADA lost, and to push for an alternative reporting system for our incoming year, and to create a roadmap to reopening that accounts for best practices that anyone can use, be it small, rural, suburban, and urban. We recognize that California is a diverse environment. On the advocacy side, as we know, today, the Department of Finance released their fiscal update, and the situation is dire given that the state delayed the collection of personal income tax revenues coming into. Expectation that there may be a $54 billion shortfall, with $18.3 billion impacting Proposition 98. Our goal at both DC and Sacramento is to continue to advocate for additional resources and a structure where we can mitigate these situations, which will require legislative and regulatory relief. At this time, we will ask and open up the floor. Members can raise their hand using a little icon to sign up to speak or comment, and can enter their question in the Q&A box. Christina will be moderating the order of speakers. Our goal is to determine what support, guidance, information that we can retrieve on your behalf would provide guidance and clarification during this process. Christina?
Thank you so much. At this time, the floor is clear and open.
We had the same quiet with the CBO call this morning. I think someone's phone literally had the crickets dial, and that went off at the same time. And Eric Dill was our moderator on that CBO at Santa Clara. And he's like, I think we're all just in shock today. So we'll give you a moment, just understanding that it's obviously a lot to absorb. But again, we really do appreciate any questions.
And maybe we can pose a question to get people thinking in terms of the folks that are on the call. If anyone is looking at returning employees to work in the next 30 days, and you've started having dialogue, it would be helpful to the group to understand, where you are and some of the points that you think would be important for others to consider. So if anyone is in that position, that would also be helpful to the group.
Thank you. Thank you so much. I do have some questions on the floor. Ryan Kilby, the floor is yours.
Hi, thank you. I was just wondering what CASBO's position or interpretation is under the essential work guidelines. I know some districts have been, you know, with their maintenance, custodial grounds, have been doing almost zero to some have been, you know, on like 30-hour-a-week schedules. So what is the interpretation of that, the continuity of the buildings, the maintenance of the buildings, the preparation of the grounds for reopening of the schools?
So you're asking what CASBO's position is on that?
That essential work in getting the, you know, maintaining the continuity of the schools and now getting them back into condition for reopening.
And I know we had in multiple conversations with the administration. We had mentioned government code, I believe, is 3100. I might be citing the number wrong at this time, but we had mentioned that we believe that that is a local decision that LEAs can use to determine in order to recall staff back to their facilities, and that we wanted to make sure that any executive order did not place restrictions when LEAs determine if they want to use that purview in determining which staff they consider essential workers. I know in some regions, we have asked childcare staff to return, and certain maintenance staff, as well as child nutrition folks. So on behalf of CASBO, for us, that is a locally determined decision, given the different dynamics that you experience. But we believe that it's something that LEAs have at their disposal, given the way that the government code was written.
Thank you. I have an open comment on the floor. Stephen Hovey. Stephen, the floor is yours.
Mic off. I'm trying to get into the chat room. I have a couple of areas where the question is about what kind of statutory relief or executive order would be helpful. So anyway, I'm partly in the chat. And that would be on the STIPS and PIPS permits for teachers. Somewhere around 30%, in some cases, in some districts, even higher than that, their teachers have less than a preliminary or clear credential, especially in special education. CTC is providing some flexibility, but they can't waive the statute. There. So that would be one where we might ask for support. And second, also related to teaching is substitutes. Though this has been brought up in other times, is the constraint of the 30-day permit, substitute permit, as it pertains to special education teachers being limited to 20 days. Is very problematic in this environment, particularly if we're going to be providing compensatory services or additional services to students with special needs. So those are two areas that we could use some relief.
Thank you.
Thank you. I have a question on the floor from Kurt. Kurt, would you like to speak to your question?
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes.
I was just wondering if there is any outlook in terms of the state relaxing the minute day requirement as they relate to ADA and funding. If we're looking at these alternative models and there is an expectation of the number of minutes a student's going to be in the classroom or the number of days of the school year, I know there has been discussion about furloughs for both the 2020-21 and the 2021-22 school year, but is the state going to potentially relax some of those reporting requirements or change the way the reporting is done so that if we have students that are on an alternative day schedule or an AM PM schedule to where the distance learning offsets that time.
Yeah, Kurt, thank you for your question. I think that that has risen to, you know, one of those key decisions that'll have to be made, then all of these other decisions can sort of follow, right? And so I would say moving to the top is the discussion around instructional minutes. That's a really big one that I think everyone, even as recent as this morning, we're in agreement that that has to be answered. And then there definitely is support of moving to an enrollment-based versus ADA relating to that. So those conversations we believe are some of the pivotal ones that once made, then folks can start to actually do more planning around all of those areas that you see on the slide here. So thank you.
Thank you. I have a couple more questions on the floor. Kathy, I have a question from you. Would you like to speak to your question? Kathy Leisure. All right, Kathy has a question on the board. What is the recommendation for allowing employees to take the new Families First FMLA intermittently in regard to childcare? A day at a time, week at a time, et cetera? Does that come through all right?
Yes, that did come.
Oh, Nina. Go ahead.
I was going to ask you, Nina, if you had thoughts.
Well, my understanding is, unfortunately, that they could break it up. And so if you don't have, if you haven't had conversation with your legal counsel with regards to that, then I would say definitely do that on that particular one, because you may be challenged on it and you want to make sure that you have a defensible argument with regards to how you're moving forward. But in the conversations that we've had in our office, and I need to also do a thank you to Renee Hendrick, who is an associate superintendent here at our office, and also Connie Kavanaugh at Saddleback Unified down here in Orange County, because they've been having a lot of conversation around this as they're working with HR professionals across our county to ensure that what we're establishing is doable. But related to your question, the answer that we received initially has been that that is flexible, that they do have the option of breaking that up like they can with some of the other leaves that are federally mandated.
Thank you, Nina. I have a raised hand. Susan Reagan, the floor is yours. Susan, would you like to speak? All right, Susan, if you'd like to address the floor, if you want to put your question in the Q&A box, I can definitely grab you again. And with that, at this time, the floor is clear and open.
We want to make sure that you, as part of this slide deck, we also have resources and information that we're trying to put together. And any further questions and information, please direct them at my email at sbaches@casba.org under topic reopening schools. This is an ongoing conversation. We will be setting up weekly forums as we get closer to May revision and figuring out what also needs to take place. We're engaging in nightly conversations staff as well as the governor's office, and our goal really is to ensure that you have the tools needed and necessary as we weather the storm. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you.